Namaste. Today, I want to talk about one of the most important topics in Vedic astrology, and that is the timing of events. This is such a important topic that I will say that no step can be taken, or even the sages and the classics have opined that no prediction should be made without knowing the timing of events. So classics give us a pretty simple opinion about it. Classics are of the opinion that suppose someone is going to have a Raji Yoga, someone is having a Raji Yoga in the horoscope. Now suppose that Raji Yoga is going to fructify at the age of 60, but the person is only having longevity at up to the age of 50 only. In that scenario, what will be the consequences? The person will die first and the Raji Yoga may actually not fructify. As a practicing astrologer, many a times I come across people who generally complain that, sir, I have this particular combination in my horoscope. This is a known combination for wealth, but I am not wealthy. This is a known combination for Raji Yoga, but I am not enjoying any power in my life. Why this is happening? You know, this for the new students, I think this creates a doubt in their mind about the authenticity of astrology, which actually should not be the case. Right? This is the place where the timing of events become very important. You may have a very good horoscope and the Raji Yogas, Dhani Yogas, and all the good combinations are going to start at the age of 26. And right now you are only 23 or 25 years of age. Then of course the things are not going to happen in your life right now. And this can create a problem. And this is not only for that current time. It is also important for the time which is gone. For an example, many a times you see horoscopes where the person enjoyed a lot of power, money, etc. at a point of time. But now everything is gone. Now he have lost everything. And then people complain that, sir, you know, that time I was earning very good amount of money. Now I'm struggling in my life. Why this? All this thing is dependent on the timing of events. Right? That is something that needs to be understood first of all. This is the importance. Classics have put the timing of events into a very high pedestal. For an example, take Bihad Jatak, a celebrated classic. Now, many learned authors have opined that Varahamihir have dealt with all the principles of predictive astrology in the first 10 chapters of Bihad Jatak only. Now, if you go by this opinion and read the first 10 chapters of Bihad Jatak, you will find that there is a mention of Dasha, Antar Dasha. There is a mention of transit, but there is no mention of yogas or rather planetary results through, you know, a planet being situated in a particular house, a planet being situated in a particular Rashi, a planet being lord of one particular house, being placed in another house. These results, Bhava-based results, Rashi-based results, house lordship-based results are not included in those 10 most important chapters of Bihad Jatak. But the timing of event is actually included. So this tells us this particular thing that the timing of events are pretty important. And also remember the examples that I have given you in the starting, right? Because generally a person may have a very good horoscope and still he can be suffering because the good times are going to come in future or the good times have already passed. Now, you as a practicing astrologer, to be successful, you should know when that time is going to come or have that time already passed. Only if you have this knowledge, you will be able to guide your clients or people whom horoscope you will look into properly, right? So this is something that is very important to be dealt with. Here in this video, I am going to present to you a very new tried and tested formula for timing events based on transits. So watch the video till the end to understand the complete technique. I have also included an example to explain it to you. And also I have made a PDF specifically for this particular video or rather presentation, right? So that PDF will also be very much useful, right? This PDF can be obtained through my website. The procedure to obtain the PDF and how to get it, I will leave it in the description section below the video, right? Or I will rather update it if I update it in the community or and on my other social media handles. Now, this timing of event, this thing is pretty important as I have already emphasized about it. So from tomorrow, the 10th of November, Wednesday, I'm going to do a course named Kaal Nirnay. I did this course way back in 2018-19. But now I am going to teach an updated version of it. The part of the course that I did in 2018-19 had a few techniques. And of course, after I have taught the technique, I have also been using those techniques to time events. So now it is an updated version of the course, right? Updated version of the course with all new techniques. The techniques that were taught in the course at that point of time, they are now not being taught. In the course, I am going to deal with 5 amazing, brilliant, time-tested, easy and simple techniques to time events. It is a 5-day. It is a 5-class webinar or course. You can say it is rather a course. It is a 5-class course where we are going to have classes every Wednesday starting from 8 p.m. in the night so that everyone, even the office goers, can join conveniently, right? And in these 5 classes, every class, we will learn a new technique to time event. And these techniques will be like, these techniques are the techniques that I have been using in my practice to predict events. So they work brilliantly. And along with this, these techniques are also very simple. So if you don't know how to time events, if you have, you know, like tried timing events, but you know, not being able to successfully do it, I'm pretty sure that this particular course will be very helpful for you to start predicting. And all these techniques are very simple. So, you know, there is not much jargon or not much difficulty into practicing it, right? So this is about the course, right? And this is one of the techniques that I'm letting go for free. And this works very brilliantly. Now, the 5 techniques that I have chosen to teach in the webinar, you imagine, teach in the course. You imagine if this technique is so brilliant, what will be those 5 techniques that I am going to teach in a paid course? They are even more brilliant than this particular technique that I am going to teach you today. So I particularly think that if you have a motive to learn astrology in the traditional authentic way, if you want to practice as an astrologer, if you want to gain authentic bona fide astrological knowledge, this is a webinar that you should not miss, or for that matter, any course of mine, you should not be missing. Like, don't miss any of the course. Regarding the timing of events, I have earlier done a course by the name of Dasha Bheda that is available to purchase. There is another course by the name of Tajik System Jyotish that is based on the concept of yearly charts, also known as Tajik Astrology. These 2 courses for timing events and how to time events, these 2 courses are also running on the same topic. And this is a 3rd new forthcoming course that is going to come. As it is clear from the name itself, Dasha Bhed deals with dashas and the way I use them. Tajik is based on the concept of yearly charts. And Karl Nirnay, this particular course is going to give you 5 of my time tested, proven easy techniques to time events. And none of these techniques are dependent on a dasha. These 5 techniques are independent. So even if you master one of them, timing of the events will be very easy for you. All right. Now let's start with the presentation. So this particularly works on transit. This works on the principles of transit, rather. Right? So first of all, we have to understand it. We have to understand how it works. This PDF will help you in doing so. So first of all, this chakra, this table, have to be remembered. You can do 2 things right now. You can either take the screenshot of this, or you can go to the website and you can download it. Download the whole PDF. Right? Or you can take a screenshot of it right now. So the concept is pretty simple. There are nakshatras. And these nakshatras have a relationship with each other. And this relationship is marked by these arrows. So Ashwini have a relationship with Purva Falguni, have a relationship with Rohini, see this line, see this arrow, and have a relationship with Moola. Ashwini have a relationship with these 3 nakshatras. Bharani, see this arrow, have a relationship with Magha. See this arrow, have a relationship with Kritika. And see this arrow, have a relationship with Anuradha as well. In the same example, Kritika is having a relationship with Shravana. See the arrow. Kritika is having a relationship with Bharani. And Kritika is also having a relationship with Vishakha. These nakshatras are interconnected. What we are supposed to do is we have to see the transit of planets through nakshatras. And for those who are new to astrology, let me tell you that this is a very, very, like, you know, this is something that is not very common. You must have heard of transit of planets through Rashis. And to check it from the ascendant, or to check it from the moon sign, or to check it from the sun sign, or to check it from the planet. That is all very basic astrology. When you go to advanced astrology, more emphasis is paid to the transit of planets through nakshatras. Why? Because nakshatra, as the name itself suggests, indicates nakshatra. Those karmas which cannot be avoided, those karmas which cannot be destroyed. So basically that means that if the transit of planet through Rashis, whatever karma they indicate, whatever things they indicate, those results, those things can be avoided by doing proper remedial measures or by applying other remedies. And the result or the effect of planets as per the transit are also sometimes compromised by the help of dasha and by other combinations in the horoscope. This is about the Rashi result. But nakshatras indicate those results which cannot be obstructed, which cannot be averted. So because you cannot avert or ignore or get an escape through this particular result, through any means, checking the transit of planets throughout the nakshatras are pretty important. And I think this is a topic which is untouched up to this extent. It is a very virgin area. I think I am one of those 1% of astrologers who is talking about the transit of planets through nakshatras on YouTube, I think. Fine. I'm pretty sure that you have taken the screenshot or made this chakra in your notebook by this time. If you haven't done that, just go to the website and download the PDF. This chakra is given there. Right. Now coming to nakshatras. Now in this previous chakra, we talked about nakshatras. But how these nakshatras are important to you or how they function, that is an important thing to know. So nakshatras, the 27 nakshatras are divided into three sets. One is the Janmatara set, as you can see here. One is this Janmatara set. Another is this Karmatara set. And the third is this Adhanatara set. These are the three sets of the nakshatras. Janma means birth. Karma means the duties one should do. And Adhana means conception of person. Further, these nakshatras are divided into Janma, that means birth, Sampad, that means wealth, Vipad, that means danger, Chema, that means well-being, Pratyak, that means obstruction, Sadhak, that means easily achievable, Badhak, that again means obstruction, Mitra, that means friendly, and Atimitra, that means very, very friendly. So this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, these, whatever these I have written, this have to be counted from your moon, right? So you say that your moon is supposed in Adra. So the first Tara, Janma Tara, will be Adra. The second Tara will be the Tara which falls in next to Adra. What is that Tara which falls next to Adra? Do we know that? The Tara that falls next to Adra is Punarvasu. So Tara number 2 will be Punarvasu. Tara number 3 will be Pushya. Tara number 4 will be Aslesha. Tara number 5 will be Magha, and so on and so forth. I have given an example of Modi ji later in this, Sri Narendra Modi ji, our honorable prime minister in this particular stuff. So Narendra Modi ji is basically born in Anuradha Nakshatra. His moon at the time of birth is in Anuradha Nakshatra. So the Janma Tara, the first Tara is Anuradha, followed by Jeshtha, Mula, Purvasada, Uttarashada, Sravanata, Nishtha, Satadisha, Purva, Bhadra, Prat, Uttara, Bhadra, Prat, Revati, Ashwani, Harani, Kratka, Rohini, Mrigashira, Atra, Punarvasu, Pushya, Aslesha, Magha, Purva, Falguni, Uttara, Falguni, Hasta, Chitra, Swati, Vishaka. So just starting from this first Tara, this is right here, you have to write the nakshatra occupied by moon, your natal moon. And then the next nakshatras will fill up these places of the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, right? It goes in this order, right below. Once this is completed, the next order. When this is completed, the next order. It goes in this particular way. In this also, the third Tara is known as Vipad, danger. The fourth Tara is Jati, that is either the clan or the family. The fifth Tara is Pratyari. Pratyari means the open enemy, enemy that is just facing you. The seventh Tara is Vadha Tara. Vadha, that means killing someone. Tenth Tara is Karma. As I already know, Karma indicates what one is supposed to do, the pending karmas. 12th Tara is Desh Tara, that means country. 13th Tara is Abhishek Tara, that means coronation. The 16th Tara is Sanghat Tara, that means being attacked by people. The 18th Tara is Samudaya Tara, that means the clan. The 19th Tara is Adhana Tara, known as conception. The 22nd Tara is Vainashik Tara, known for destruction. The 25th Tara is Manas Tara, that indicates your mental qualities and attributes, the peace of mind. The 26th Tara is Jati Tara, once again indicates family and the clan. The 27th Tara is also known as Desha, which means country, and Abhisheka, which means coronation. So these are the special nakshatras. So what you have to do, first of all, you have to take the nakshatra of your moon and place it at the place of Janmatara. Then other nakshatras will occupy the place of the second Tara, third Tara, fourth Tara, fifth Tara, sixth Tara, and so on up to the 27th Tara. After that, you are also supposed to write the planets that are situated in that Tara. And if there is a planet situated there, that particularly indicates how that Tara is going to work. I will come back to the table for Modi ji. Janma Tara moon will always be there, so you leave it. We find that in Dhanishtha Nakshatra, which is the Vadha or Naidhan Tara for Modi ji, there is Jupiter. So Jupiter is not actually a good planet for Modi ji. Jupiter may cause him bad results as per Vadh, you know, Vadh means killing. Rahu indicates karma because that is in the Karma Tara. And as you know, Rahu also indicates foreign lands. So Modi ji keeps on visiting foreign lands a lot and getting support from there. He have also been awarded multiple times by foreign countries. He made India proud in the international world scheme, right? So his karma is rather indicated by Rahu. If you see his chart, I use his chart. I use this chart for Modi ji. This chart with Libra Lagna, the birth details are 17th September 1950, time 9:34:13 at Vadnagar, Gujarat. Because I use Chandrahari Ayanamsha, when you use this time and make the horoscope, it may be a little bit of different. So make sure to fix the Lagna degree at 11 degree and 36 minutes in Libra. I use this particular chart. If you see the table, Rahu indicates the karma. And in his horoscope, Rahu is situated in the sixth house of enemies. So his major karma is to make India and make his dharma, Hindu dharma, free of his enemies, free the Hindu dharma from his enemies, from the clutches of suppression. That is also indicated by the sixth house. So this is how you are supposed to read this particular table for natal horoscopes. Now going further, we find that Vainashik Nakshatra is having Venus. Purva Falguni is the Vainashik Nakshatra for Modi ji that is having Venus, which means Venus is destructive for Modi ji. And we know Venus indicates woman and Modi ji as like separated from his wife. He never consummated his marriage. So the destruction part is not there in his life. At least he haven't activated the destruction part himself. Right? You can further once again read Venus in the horoscope of Modi ji. Check the Dasha Antar Dasha of Venus in the horoscope of Modi ji, and you will surprisingly found that in the Dasha Antar Dasha of Venus, Modi ji actually had sufferings, right? Whenever we say death astrologically, it may not always mean actual death, but it may mean other humiliations or rather say other bad conditions, which is very akin to death. Like being humiliated by people, losing things, etc. These are also very akin to death. So basically, death, Naidhan, Vainashik, these things should be taken as something bad. Like bad results. It should be taken as bad results. Going further, we find that Uttara Falguni is having Sun, Mercury, Saturn, and Ketu in the horoscope of Modi ji, but that doesn't get designation of any special nakshatra. So let's leave it. It will be used for seeing the influence of nakshatras over each other. We further find that Swati Nakshatra, which is the Jati Nakshatra, is having Lagna. Now, Jati means clan, family, kinsmen. And we know that Modi ji won with the huge majority. Lagna being in the Jati Nakshatra does indicate that Modi ji considers the whole world as his family. And this is very much evident in his decisions, in his decision of giving Indian citizenship to Hindus living in the neighboring countries of India, right? So Lagna being in Jati Nakshatra indicates the great support that Modi ji had in 2014, and he had it again in 2019, right? So Lagna being in Jati Nakshatra indicates that this person is a darling of many. And we see that Mars in the Vishakha Nakshatra, which is the 27th Nakshatra of Abhisheka, gives him coronation, gives him position in life. So Mars is the planet, you know, Mars is the planet that gives him power, that gives him rulership over the desha, rulership over the country, which gives him coronation. Mars. So when you check the dasha antar dashas of Mars, you will see that dashas antar dashas of Mars for Modi ji have been very good, have been very beneficial, and they have given a lot of power to Modi ji. That's what coronation means, you know, gain of power, getting a seat, getting a position in life. This table you can make for your own horoscope and can analyze the results of dasha antar dasha using this table as well. The importance of this table cannot be emphasized much. If you actually want to know how brilliant this technique is, you will have to make this table for your own horoscope and check dasha antar dashas for your chart. And I am pretty sure that if you apply the correct dasha antar dasha for your horoscope, you will be amazed to see the result that this table produces. Having learned this, I have, for the benefit of all, have compiled some special transit rule. First of all, the first, the 10th and the 19th nakshatra, which is the Janma, Karma and Adhana nakshatra, on the day of sun's entry into a sign, which is known as Surya Sankranti, or at that day when any planet transits a new sign, or on the day where eclipse falls, like for this month there is an eclipse on 19th November, or on the day of planetary fight when two planets are in the same degree, they are considered to be in a planetary fight: Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, Mercury. When these planets are in the same sign, in the same degree, they are considered to be in a planetary fight. So whenever sun enters a new Rashi, whenever any planet enters a new Rashi, whenever an eclipse happens, or whenever there are two planets in the same sign, in the same Rashi, at that day, you should specifically check the position of that particular planet and the Vedhas that it makes, and specifically the Vedas, the influences, the relationships that moon makes as per this particular table, and that will tell you the result. For an example, when sun transits in a sign, on that day you have to check the nakshatra of sun and the nakshatra of moon and see which other nakshatras they are influencing and what special positions those nakshatras have in your horoscope. When a planetary transit happens, when a planet transits into a new sign, when a planet enters into a new sign, when a planet starts retrograding from its direct motion, on that day, you should use this table to check the influences of moon and the planet over different nakshatras and what it activates. The same should be done for the day of eclipse. On that particular day, you should see which nakshatras are being influenced by sun and moon according to the table and what results it is activating. And then there is a planetary fight. Two planets are in the same degree. Planets, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, Mercury. When these two are in the same sign, same degree, at that day also, you should check the influences of these planets, whoever is in the planetary fight, and moon. Influence of these planets over the other nakshatras as per the TV's table, and that will tell you what type of result it is actually activating. I will give you an example. For take an example. Right now, take this. This is the horoscope for today, November 9, 2021. There is going to be an eclipse on 19th November 2021 at 11:32 in the, 11:32 in the morning. The sun is in the 11th house, that's the morning time. 11:32, there is going to be an eclipse. We find moon in Kritika Nakshatra and sun in Vishakha. Now you go to this table. Sun from Vishakha influences Dhanishtha, influences Kritika, and influences Anuradha. So if you are having any planet in Dhanishtha Nakshatra, Kritika Nakshatra, Anuradha Nakshatra, or Vishakha Nakshatra, the results or the things signified that things signified by that planet will be activated negatively for you, because eclipse is a negative event. Also, if this Dhanishtha, Anuradha, Vishakha or Kritika is any of the special nakshatras for you, then also it will be a problem. For an example, if any of these are your Manas nakshatras, you are going to have mental tensions in this period. The result of eclipse is applicable for the next 4 months. So for the next 4 months, you are going to have mental, depression or, mental troubles and tribulations if your Manas Nakshatra is falling in these four stars, in these four nakshatras. If it is the Karma Nakshatra for you, there are going to be professional disturbances. If these are the Jati Nakshatra for you, family life will be disturbed, etc. In the same way, moon is in Kritika. Kritika influences Shravan. Kritika influences Bharani. And Kritika influences Vishakha also. So once again, the principle that we applied for sun, the same principle have to be applied for moon also. Basically, if you are having any planet in Dhanishtha, Bharani, Kritika, Shravana, Anuradha or Vishakha, this eclipse is going to disturb the results indicated by that planet for the next 4 months. And if there are any special nakshatras falling in these six nakshatras, like Manas Nakshatra, there will be mental tensions. If it is Karma Nakshatra, there will be professional issues. If it is the Jati Nakshatra, there will be family life or marital life problems. If this is the Adhana Nakshatra, then problem related to children will be there. If this is Abhishek Nakshatra, then problem related to gain of power, promotion, etc. will be there. Right? It have to be understood in this particular way. After this, we come to the next transit role. These rules highlight that the analysis of a transit chart is also very much akin or equivalent to the analysis of a natal chart itself. So the next rule says that malefic planets aspected by benefics in transit loses their trait to give malefic results. And the same is the case with benefic planets who in transit, when get expected by malefic planets, they lose their beneficence. Right? This is like to exemplify. This is a transit chart for this moment. And here you can see, or rather I will say, when we use such words like malefic planet aspected by benefics or benefic planet aspected by malefics, here it should not be literally taken as an aspect only, but should be taken as a relationship. In the current transit chart, you can see that Mars, Sun, and Mercury, these three planets are together. Now, there's a special rule about Mercury that when Mercury conjoins with a malefic planet, he becomes a malefic. So this particular combination of Mars, Sun, and Mercury, this tends to remain a malefic combination. Now, the sign Libra, because this combination is happening in the sign Libra is negatively afflicted. And those who are having major planets in Libra, those who are having Libra ascendant, those who are having Libra moon sign, they are going to face some difficulties. And also the places and areas indicated by Libra, right, such as marketplaces or cities with, cities with big markets, like Delhi. Delhi is a city that is known as the market hub, Delhi, Bangalore. And these cities are going to get, going to get afflicted, going to get bad results, crime may increase in those areas, accidents may increase, etc., etc. This is how the prediction is made. Another thing is now, if you go to the 10th house in the sign Capricorn, you will find that there is Saturn, Jupiter, and Moon. Because Moon is a fast-moving planet, let's ignore it. Now, coming to this particular stuff, the Saturn-Moon combination in the sign of Capricorn is further aspected by Rahu from Taurus. So what happens in this scenario? Saturn, a malefic being connected by Jupiter, will not give his malefic result because Jupiter is a benefic. In the same way, Jupiter being a benefic, getting under the influence of Saturn and under the influence of Rahu, two malefics, will tend to lose his benefic result giving nature. However, if you do a comparative analysis with the combination formed by Rahu and Saturn, two malefics, Jupiter is quite afflicted. So that means all the people having major planets in the sign Capricorn, having Capricorn ascendant, having Moon in Capricorn, etc., they are going to suffer in the significations, suffer through the significations of Saturn and Rahu. So there can be sudden events in those areas ruled by the planets placed in Capricorn. Or sudden events can happen in the life of those people having Capricorn ascendant or Moon in the Capricorn sign. Right? Sudden events can happen because of Rahu. Cheating can happen because of Rahu. Deception can happen because of Rahu. Melancholy can happen because of Saturn. Depression can happen because of Saturn. Frustration can happen because of Saturn. Not getting your due credit can happen because of Saturn. And all these things can happen. And in the same way, the areas ruled by Capricorn and the people whose name, the first letter of the name falls in Capricorn, they are also going to suffer. Areas ruled by Capricorn are beaches, right? Where areas ruled by Capricorn is beach areas, where there is water and where there is land. So those areas are going to have problems related to Rahu and Saturn. Now, Rahu and Saturn generally doesn't create any natural disaster or that kind of a thing, but rather causes disease and misery and also a lot of deaths. So in this particular transit, by the time Saturn, Jupiter and Rahu is in their respective positions by the time Rahu is in Taurus, Saturn is in Capricorn, Jupiter is in Capricorn, you will find that a lot of people from the beach areas, a lot of people living in the beach areas are dying or getting some diseases, and these problems are, like, these problems will happen. If you remember, even after the second wave of corona was over, we were getting new news every day regarding some new mutation or variation of corona from states like Hyderabad, Andhra Pradesh and Kerala. And these, all the places are beach places, which are, you know, places where water and land, both of them is available. Generally, the seashore, the seaside area. Now we understand through the eyes of astrology why this is happening. This is happening because of Saturn, Jupiter being in Capricorn and Rahu from Taurus aspecting this particular combination. So this makes this particular transit, and it is a very long transit, right? This makes this particular transit a very challenging one, but it is soon going to get over, as Jupiter is 28 degrees and Rahu is 6 degrees and Saturn is 12 degrees, though Saturn will take a lot of time to come out of Capricorn. But Jupiter is soon going to leave Capricorn. Now, with Jupiter leaving Capricorn, the malefic results are only enhanced. And it is not calmed down, right? The same principle. Once Jupiter gets out of Capricorn, there will be no benefic influence over this Rahu Saturn aspect on the sign Capricorn, right? The going of Jupiter from Capricorn will make this combination a complete malefic. So once Jupiter is out of Capricorn and there is only Rahu left in Taurus and Saturn left in Capricorn, the people with Capricorn ascendant, people having Capricorn moon sign, people having a lot of planets in Capricorn, and people specifically living to seaside areas, beach areas, seashore areas, they are going to suffer a lot. Specifically on the accounts of disease, misery, etc. So this is how the predictions are done. The next rule says that planets aspected by malefics in transit are weak and cannot give their transit results completely. This is how this should be taken into consideration. I will tell you that. Just referring to the same current transit position of Jupiter in Capricorn. Now suppose someone is having a Capricorn Lagna and he is having Jupiter in Capricorn. Jupiter being a benefic planet should indicate good results from the ascendant. That means name, fame, power, freedom from disease, good health and all these things. Jupiter transiting in ascendant should indicate. But now, because this Jupiter is being conjoined by Saturn and aspected by Rahu from Taurus, the results of Jupiter in the ascendant, the result that Jupiter gives, gain of health, freedom from disease, name, fame, power, status, happiness, comforts, etc. These results, Capricorn people or people having their moon in Capricorn will find difficult to get. Right, this is how it means. These rules, I'll tell you, these rules are very, very important, right? Because there is one general query regarding transit, that if we talk of planetary transits, they come again and again. If you say Jupiter in the fifth house will give children, then Jupiter in the fifth house comes again and again, right? Multiple times, Jupiter, we say Jupiter connected to the fifth house gives children in 12 years, considering the three aspects of Jupiter in one placement. In 12 years, Jupiter will be making connection with the fifth house four times. In that scenario, how do we actually time events using transit? If we employ such formulas, then it will be better. Then we will get better techniques and better tools to predict through transits, right? So this is something that have to be taken into consideration. These rules, they cannot be ignored. Going further, The next rule says that planet, even while transiting bad houses, if they are in their good signs, they only give good result. For an example, I'll tell you a small story. My ascendant is Aquarius. So basically Saturn is transiting the 12th house. So this transit, the transit of Saturn in the 12th house should be actually bad for me and all other Aquarius people. But I have found that Aquarius people are, or you will find that Aquarius people are actually doing well in their life in this time, despite the fact that Saturn is transiting through their 12th house. This is because of this particular technique. That planet, in this case Saturn, even while transiting bad houses, if they are in their good signs are the signs of exaltation and own sign. If they are in their good signs, they give good result and they don't give bad results. This rule, if you try to understand it, this rule have a secret. And that secret is something that is going to, this rule is going to break a lot of conceptions. Generally, while considering the transit, we consider the placement of planet in houses for predictions, right? This is what we generally do. But if you look at this rule closely, if you try to understand this rule closely, you will find that this concept is not right. Generally, how do we predict transit? Oh, this planet is transiting through your sixth house. You are going to have bad results related to this planet, etc., etc. You know, this is how we see transit. This is how we judge transit. This is how we try to read it. But this rule gives us an underlying fundamental understanding that the transit should also be seen with respect to Rashi and should not be seen with respect to houses. If you read classics properly, you will find that results are generally predicted based on good transits. For an example, Faldipika states the rule that if the Dasha Lord is transiting through their exaltation sign or their own sign or the friendly sign, then good result related to that Dasha Antar Dasha is felt. Right? This point should be understood that transit of planet through Rashi is something that is very important. I should also understand one fact. I think because people don't understand it, this problem happens. If you follow my teachings properly, you will know that I don't use Chalit Chakra, Chalit Horoscope, or Bhava Horoscope, however it is, whichever way you pronounce it, whichever way you refer to it. Now, why I don't refer it? You try to understand a point. Your ascendant of the horoscope, ascendant of your horoscope is decided based on the place you are born in. That decides the ascendant. Planetary position is same for everyone. Saturn is in Capricorn. Saturn is in Capricorn for me. Saturn is in Capricorn for you. And Saturn is in Capricorn for everyone. So the date and time decides the planetary position. And that is same for everyone. Now, time and place decides the ascendant of the person. Right now, I am sitting in India. It is 5:28 right now. So at this time, at 5:28, I am getting Aries ascendant. If you go to US, someone sitting in USA right now, it is not 5:28. Neither it is an Aries ascendant, right? So the ascendant is decided based on the time of birth and place of birth. And this is ascendant that decides the different houses. For an example, right now it is Aries ascendant, so the second house is Taurus. But for someone sitting in USA, right now it will not be Aries ascendant and Taurus will not be the second house, right? So the concept of houses is actually based on the place where I am sitting. Now the planets in the sky are transiting throughout the Rashi. There are nakshatras in the sky, there are stars in that nakshatras, and when we join those stars through a hypothetical imaginative line, that make different shapes. And these different shapes are identified as nakshatras and rashis. Planets actually transit through them. Planets don't transit through houses. In reality, Saturn is just in Capricorn. Now, this Capricorn is the 12th house for me, and it can be any other house for you. That is something that needs to be understood. And because from the perspective of the sky, there is no house division, and we are dealing with astral signs, I don't use Chalit Chakra or Bhava Kundalini. Right? There are many more reasons for not using it. Maybe I am planning to make a video on it since long, but time constraints. So nonetheless. Now, before I go back to the slide, I want to introduce to you one more rule. That is Saturn. I will just tell you one part of the rule. Saturn and Moon give the result of the transit throughout the last 10 degrees of the Rashi. Mars and Sun give the result of the transit through the 0 degree to 10 degree of the Rashi. Venus and Jupiter give the result of their transit through 10 degrees to 20 degrees of the Rashi. So reflecting back to the technique that I just taught with, I just told you that Saturn in Capricorn will create problems in areas and problems to people, problems in areas related to Capricorn and problem to people having prominent planets in Capricorn, having ascendant in Capricorn, having moon in Capricorn. But when he will create the actual problem, Saturn is in Capricorn since long, when he will create the real problem. Just remember the fact that Saturn and Moon give their result in the from the 20 degree to 30 degree of the sign. Now, if you just move this transit, you will find that from February 2022, in February 2022, Saturn will be in 21 degree Capricorn. So from February 2022 up to May 2022, from February 2002 to May 2022, the actual implications of and the actual bad results of Saturn in the sign Capricorn for the people having major planets in Capricorn, having ascendant in Capricorn, having moon sign in Capricorn, and for the people residing in the area ruled by Capricorn, the seaside area, the seashore area, the real result will be felt. The real bad result will be felt between February 2022 up to June 2022. This is something that needs to emphasize the same fact, the same technique that I was telling, the transit of planets through Rashis being very important. The same thing is dealt with in the next technique that says that if a planet is an inimical sign, if the planet is in his debilitation sign, or if a planet is combust, then the transit of that planet will not be able to give their good results because they are weak. Whereas the bad result of those planets will be very prominent. And this is one of the most important rule that needs to be understood. Generally, people are afraid about how the transit of Saturn, how the Sade Sati, how the Dhaya, how the Kandakshani, and all these transits, how it is going to impact us, how it is going to affect us, what results it will produce. Just remember this particular technique in mind. If the planets are debilitated, planets are placed in inimical sign, planets are combust, in that scenario, the malefic transits of the planets are very lethal. So those who are having Saturn in inimical sign, that means Saturn in Leo, Saturn in Aries, Saturn in Scorpio, Saturn in Cancer, not actually Cancer, Cancer should not be taken as an inimical sign. People having Saturn in Aries, Saturn in Leo, Saturn in Scorpio, or those who are having Saturn combust, and those who are having Saturn in, specifically in Aries, for them, the bad transits of Saturn are very, very bad, right? So this particular thing have to be taken into consideration. If a planet is placed in his inimical sign, is debilitated or is combust, the good transit of that planet doesn't produce result, but the bad transit of that planet is very lethal, very troublesome, very problematic. The same technique can be applied for those planets who are powerful. Planets who are exalted, planets who are then who are in their friendly signs, planet who are in their own signs. Their bad transit doesn't produce much bad result, but their good transit gives a lot of good results to people, right? So the transit should actually be understood. What we understand from these few techniques is that the transits should actually be understood with regard to the rashis that planets occupy while in transit. The intensity of result, either good or bad, whatever a planet will produce is highly dependent on the type of sign that the planet originally occupy in the natal chart or in the birth horoscope. And thirdly, the aspects and conjunctions of planets with each other is also applicable while judging the transits. These are the few rules that we come to know. Coming back to our original topic, these few rules I have just included in between to for those people who are there are many people who don't understand complex techniques much, so just for them, right? And these are very essential, right? Before you use this particular technique that I am, this particular chakra that I am presenting in this video, a general understanding of how transits work is pretty important. Now, this is the chart for Modi ji. What I have done is the moon of Modi ji is in Anuradha Nakshatra. So starting from Anuradha Nakshatra, I have put all the nakshatras in the table, Anuradha, Jyeshtha. So first nakshatra being Anuradha, that is Janmatara. Jyeshtha, the second nakshatra, Moola. The third nakshatra becoming Vipattara. Purvashada, the fourth nakshatra becoming Jatitara. Uttarashada becoming Pratritara. Dhanishtha having Jupiter in it becoming Naidhantara. Uttarabhadra with Rahu in it becoming Karmatara. Ashwini becoming the Deshatara. Bharani becoming the Abhishekatara. Mrigashira becoming the Sanghatatara. Punarvashu becoming the Samudayatara. Pushya becoming the Adhanatara. Purva Falguni with Venus into it becoming the Vainashiktara. Uttara Falguni is having Sun, Mercury, Saturn and Ketu, but this nakshatra doesn't get any special signification, so it is left blank. Chitra becoming the Manastara. Swati having ascendant in this nakshatra becomes the Jatitara. And Mars in the Vishakha nakshatra gets the designation of Desatara and Abhishekatara. As I have already told, results can also be read through this particular table. So Ashwini becoming the Deshatara indicates that under the governance of Modi ji, the country, our country, India, will do very fast-paced progress. That is indicated by the horses of Ashwini, right? Great progress India will do. Bharani being the Abhishek Tara indicates that the coronation of Modi ji, the rise of Modi ji to power, is causing death-like circumstances to many people. Mrigashira being the Sanghatatara, Sanghat that means attack. Mrigashira indicates people who are not very dangerous. Mrigashira indicates common people, right? specifically you know bholi bhali janta, specifically people who are not very shrewd, specifically people who are not very intelligent. That is what Mrigashira indicates. Simple people. Simple people given power. So because that is indicated by Mrigashira. Because that is Sanghaktara. Moti ji should specifically be aware of those people who are not much shrewd, who have a normal level of intelligence, and even with normal level of intelligence, they are endowed with much power. He should be beware of those people. Punarvasu nakshatra being the samudaya tara. Punarvasu. Punarvasu, the word itself means the reconstruction or settlement of the lost or the destroyed city. So samudaya tara being punarvasu does indicate that Modi ji have a major karma of restoring, repopulating, remaking things. So the Tower of Unity, celebrating the great patriot again, right? The Rama Janmabhoomi, making Ayodhya again, making the Rama temple again. Modi ji, why he is doing all this? Why he is on the revival of our lost tradition? That is because of Punarvasu being in Samudaya Tara. Samudaya means the clan, Samudaya means the family. And we Indians are the family of Modi ji. What he is going to do with us? He is going to do Punarvasu with us. He is going to re-establish, rediscover, and repopularize those things which are lost, forgotten, etc. In this way, this table can be read. You can read it for your own chart also. You can make this table for your own horoscope and read the results. This is very, very important technique. A serious astrologer who wishes to predict well cannot afford to ignore this. I have written a few events. I have tried analyzing a particular event. The Modi ji swearing as Prime Minister of India, that happened on 26th May 2014. On that day, Jupiter was in Punarvasu Nakshatra, Saturn was in Vishakha Nakshatra, Sun is in Rohini Nakshatra, and Mars was in Hasta Nakshatra. Jupiter from Punarvasu Nakshatra, that is a Samudaya Tara, indicates making of the clan, which indicates he, for a politician, what is making of a clan? Having much support. This is what Modi ji got in reality. In the 2014 elections, Modi ji won with a huge majority. He had a great Samudaya. He had a great community to support him. And Jupiter from Punarvasu aspects Uttara Falguni Nakshatra, where Sun is situated. Sun indicates the gain of power. Where Mercury is situated, Mercury indicates social media. BJP IT cell supported a lot. Aspects Saturn, which indicates common people, and influences Ketu, which indicates devotion towards someone. Jupiter being a benefic planet, influencing Sun, the Karaka for power, Mercury, the Karaka of social media and social media and promotions, Saturn indicating common masses, and Ketu indicating devotion. Jupiter aspecting these planets as per this table indicates the positive activation of these things. Saturn was in Vishakha Nakshatra. That was Abhishekha Tara. Saturn, which indicates profession, in Vishakha Nakshatra, that is the Abhishekha Tara, indicates that it is the time, it was the time for Modi ji to get coronated in his profession, to get the reward in his profession. Abhishek is coronation. Abhishek is giving the highest respect to anyone. And there is also Mars in Vishakha Nakshatra. If you see the horoscope of Modi ji, I take the horoscope with Libra Lagna. This Mars is in the second house, indicating that Saturn, the servant, is influencing the second house. So Modi ji was all ready to serve his extended family, India. It should be borne in mind, it should be kept in mind that Modi ji is a politician. So everything, every house signification, we will look with the perspective of minister, with the perspective of politics. Saturn from Vishakha influences Dhanishtha Nakshatra with Jupiter into it. Jupiter. For Modi ji, Jupiter is in the fifth house. And Saturn, the Karaka for profession, influencing Jupiter, who is situated in the fifth house, indicates that it is the fifth house is ministerial position and Saturn is the Karma Karaka. Indicates that it is the time for Modi ji to do his karma, do his work as minister. And Saturn from Vishakha also aspects Moon, which is in Anuradha Nakshatra. Now Saturn being the Karma Karaka, Saturn being the Karaka for profession, is influencing Moon, the 10th Lord. Which means that this is the right time, this is the appropriate time when Modi ji should do his major karma, his most important karma for which he is born. The Karaka of profession influencing the 10th Lord of the horoscope indicates that this is the high time where the person have to do what he is destined to. Sun gives aspect to Lagna, which is in Swati Nakshatra from Rohini Nakshatra. Sun indicates power. And Sun influencing the Lagna indicates power was being gained by Modi ji. Mars was in Hasta Nakshatra, and from there he was aspecting Rahu in Uttarabhadra Nakshatra. If you see the horoscope of Modi ji, Rahu is situated in the sixth house. Mars, the Karaka for fight and competition, influencing Rahu in the sixth house. Now you see this Mars is in own Rashi. In the natal chart, the Mars is in own Rashi, whereas Rahu is in the sign of Jupiter, where he is very weak, because Rahu have no traits equivalent to Jupiter. So this is strong Mars of Modi ji, the Mars of Scorpio, is thrashing the competition and enemies indicated by the sixth house, resulting in Modi ji gaining power and becoming the Prime Minister of India. Now, as it is already told in the techniques section, that we should check the planetary aspects on the nakshatras and planetary aspects on other planets occupying those nakshatras also on that day when the planets transited or entered into those signs. We also do that. We see on 26th May 2014, Jupiter was in Gemini Nakshatra, which he actually entered on 3rd June 2013 while being in Mrigashira Nakshatra, that is the Sanghat Tara. Sanghat means attack. And Jupiter entering in the Nakshatra of attack, Jupiter the saving grace, Jupiter the most benevolent planet, saves Modi ji from any type of attack and makes sure that now this person cannot be attacked. From there, Jupiter aspected Venus, which was in Uttarasadha Nakshatra, Pratyak Tara. Pratyak against mean obstructions. Once again, the beneficence and benevolence of Jupiter cut the obstruction. And Jupiter was also influencing Chitra Nakshatra, which was the Manastara for Budhi. Manastara, which indicates mind, being influenced by Jupiter, the Karaka for religion and dharma, indicates that at the time of swarming, Modiji had the thought of serving his dharma and doing his duty as a politician by serving the nation in his mind. On 26th May 2014, Saturn was in Libra Rashi, which he entered on 14th of August 2012 in Chitra Nakshatra, which was Manastara. Manastara, indicating mind, indicates that it was in mind of Modiji to serve, because Saturn indicates servant and serving. From there, he was aspecting Mrigashira Nakshatra, which is Sanghatatara, and Moola Nakshatra, which is Vipatatara. Now, Saturn is the Karma Karaka and indicates that it is Saturn being the Karma Karaka, influencing Sanghatatara and Vipatatara, which indicates attack, Sanghat, and disaster, Vipat. Saturn, the Karaka for misery, aspecting these two, Sanghat and Vipatara, indicates that this win of Modiji, this fabulous, fantastic win of Modiji in 2014 elections, was a slap to the dangers and disasters and to those people who wanted to put dangers and disasters on Modiji. It was a great slap on them. But why Saturn, being a malefic planet, is giving such good results to Modiji? This is happening because in the natal chart of Modiji, if you see, Saturn is situated in the 11th house of gains. So this Saturn is not going to give any bad result. This Saturn is only going to give gains. But if you look at the degrees, you will find that Modiji is having Sun at 29 degree and Saturn at 28 degree. So this Saturn is highly combust. In that scenario, how Saturn is able to give result? I have already told that combust planet don't give much good results. But if you notice, at that time, on 26th May 2014, Saturn was exalted in Libra. As I have already told, the most important technique for transit is to check the transit of planets through Rashis. Sun, on 26th May 2014, was in Taurus, which he entered on 15th May 2014 in Kritika Nakshatra. From there, he was aspecting Bharani Nakshatra, which is Abhishek Tara. Abhishek means coronation, and Sun indicates power. Sun indicates authority. So this aspect of Sun to Abhishek Tara indicates that it was the time for Modiji to go and take the Abhishek for himself. Go and get coronated, because Sun indicates power, and influencing the Tara of coronation, aspecting the Tara of power, indicates that this is the time for gain of power. This is my major technique. I always teach my students that, you know, we say that moon is the Karaka for mother. That doesn't only indicate your mother. That also indicates your ability to become a mother. Sun indicates father. Not only father, Sun also indicates your ability to become a father. In the same way, Sun indicates power. Not only power, but Sun also indicates your ability to gain power. And from the Kritika Nakshatra, Sun was also giving Veda to Vishakha Nakshatra, which is once again Abhishek Nakshatra, the Nakshatra of coronation and rise of power, and Des Nakshatra, which is the Nakshatra of country. Once again signifying that Modiji was going to gain power and authority and going to get coronated because of both the Abhishek Nakshatras being activated, and he was going to get power over his country because Sun, the Karaka of power, is influencing the Desh Nakshatra, Desh Tara. On 26th of May 2014, Mars was in Virgo Rashi, which he entered on 22nd March 2014. Because Mars was retrograde, he entered up in 30 degrees of Virgo Rashi in the Chitra Nakshatra, which was Manas Tara. Manas indicating mind and Mars indicating the zeal, passion and fire indicate that Modi ji campaigned for the election, fought the election with a lot of vigor and power like a commander in chief. If you look at the speeches of Modi ji before the 2014 elections, you will be able to realize this fact. And Mars also shared the same Vedha that Saturn did. So Mars was also giving the Vedha to Brigashira Nakshatra, which is the Sanghat Tara, and Mula Nakshatra, which is the Vipat Tara. Sanghat meaning attack and Vipat meaning danger, being influenced by Mars, the commander in chief, indicates that Modi ji, like an excellent warrior, like the greatest commander in chief in battle, defeated all the attackers and defeated all the troubles and tribulations with great zeal and by showing great power. This is how these techniques are to be used. This is how this technique of one nakshatra aspecting other nakshatra have to be used. And as I have already explained, this technique you can also use to read the result of chart, as I did for Modi ji just some time ago. And this result can also be used to time events, which is very, very important in Vedic astrology. Suppose we look at the horoscope of Modi ji, and right now Modi ji is 24 years of age. He's going to take sannyas. And he comes to you and he tells you that, should I take sannyas, Panditji? Or you are an astrologer, Modi ji is 24-25 years of age, the time when he left his home and went to multiple places. He comes to you, get his chart read and asks you that I am going to take a refuge. I am going to take sannyas. Should I take it? Will you be able to tell him that time that no, don't take sannyas, you will have to serve the country in the position of prime minister? Maybe you will not be able to say it, but when Modi ji went to Ram Krishna Math in Belur and he wanted to become a monk, Swami ji there told him that it is not the path for you, you are chosen for something else. Swami ji had the divine sight because of the blessings of Shri Shri Thakur. And if we want to predict such things, see, either you become blessed, that is another scenario. There is no shortcut for being blessed. There are only few fortunate people who are fortunate enough to get blessed. Not everyone can get it. That's why we have the science of knowledge, right? That's why we have the science of knowledge. Not everyone is born rich, but with good education, you can take a good job and make yourself rich. That is why we have knowledge, so that we become able to even get those things which we are not blessed with. Swamiji, whichever Swamiji was there at Belur Math at that time, told Modi ji, refused Modi ji to give sannyas and told that you have to do some other work. But you imagine that if you are the astrologer who saw the chart of Modi ji, would you be able to predict that at the age of 24 when Modi ji is going to take sannyas? Maybe few very good astrologers will be able to point out that there are three planets in the 11th house and there is this 10th lord in the second house also. That is a combination for being a politician and you will do good in politics. But then Modi ji will tell you that there are no chance that I can become a politician. Then after 5 years when Modi ji turns 30, He comes to you, he says that, sir, you told me I will become a politician. I haven't become a politician yet. Only if you know the timing of event, you can actually tell Modi ji that at this age, you will become prime minister, and at this age, you will become chief minister. This thing, this timing of event is very, very important. If you cannot time events in astrology, sadly, you don't know astrology at all. Because if you cannot say a person when it will happen, then in that scenario, predicting good results for that person is only making him see daydreams. That's all. First of all, you should be able to find out whether this good result is going to happen in future or not. Will the person be living to enjoy the result or not? And once you find when the result is going to happen, only after that predictions make some sense. Otherwise, each and every prediction is useless. The timing of event is something which is very important and very crucial in Vedic astrology. And every serious and dedicated astrology learner should master timing of events. And to do that, you can either learn Dasha, which I teach in my Dasha Bhed course, or you can learn the concept of yearly charts, which I teach in my Tajik course. Or if you find Dasha difficult to be understood, if you don't know what an yearly chart is, first is what you can do is you can get enrolled in these courses, or you can get enrolled in my another course named Kal Nirnay, which is a 5-class course where I am going to teach 5 of my best time-tested, reliable, easy and simple techniques to time events. And these techniques works with such great accuracy that once you learn it, you will be amazed to see how beautifully these techniques work. And most importantly, these techniques are very simple to learn and practice. If you want to do any of my course and you have you think that you have missed the chance, you were not aware about the courses earlier, you see the course on my website, want to purchase it, you can purchase any course at any given point of time. The recordings will be given to you, the recordings will be delivered to you. And as my students, you always have my support. My any student enrolled in any course, doesn't matter the price of the course, doesn't matter the length of the course, nothing matters. If you are my student, even if you purchase a recorded course, my support is always there with you. You can reach me anytime, ask any of your questions, and I will be at your back 24/7. With Shubham Alok, there is, when you become my student, you always have a connection with me. Any question, any problem, any doubt, even for the recorded courses, you can tell it directly to me. And you, as my students, will always be my responsibility. Only one thing that is needed, that is devotion. Thank you for watching the video. We'll meet you in the next video. Namaskar.